This is TWiT.
I also want to talk a bit about open standards around some of the things that are going on around smart devices and things like that. I mean, these are, I'm not sure how much of it is a safety concern, although if you're doing what I'm doing, which is, putting a microcontroller and a relay in the same box as my electrical switch, I guess there could be some concern there from a safety perspective. But that's kind of what I want to get to is, where are we with open standards around smart devices, you know, either for electricity, plumbing, you know, any of this stuff? And you know, is that an area that people might want to do some work in? So that, because I know, like, you know, you have all these, we always have these different standards, right? X11, Zigbee, whatever. It's a whole mess, right? And it seems to evolve, but never land on, here's the standard, here's how we're going to communicate, you know, it's just kind of all over the place.
Right. So, yes, I think there is a huge opportunity for open source and open standard development around smart products and other kinds of products that are maybe quasi smart products. You know, it's like with everything in tech, right? The huge impetus is to own the customer and control the customer and control the relationship. And so, you know, you're getting a Nest doorbell and, you know, everything's running, or Ring, it's same thing. You know, you're running everything through a giant company, and they're collecting the information, they're doing facial recognition. The software is proprietary. It feels like, when you have one, like you barely even own what's happening at your door, right? Mm-hmm. Or the copies of the stuff. And, you know, there's the barrier to entry for making hardware plus software, right? For any of these issues is high, whether it's my iPhone, you know, that's insanely expensive and, you know, that Apple makes a ton of money on, but it's really hard for other competitors to get into that business. I mentioned the I Created Fire t-shirt before we sort of got started. And, you know, that's the Fire phone that Amazon worked on for 2 years and had six cameras in the front. And, you know, Amazon wanted to get into the high-end device and software business, right? Because look at what Apple's doing, right? Like, this is a big profit center for Apple, and they wanted to try to compete. And, you know, they made an $800 phone, and the market just went, blah, you know, whatever, meh. But it's, you know, so it's hard. So then you look at what happens in building, right? Like the doorbell, Nest or Ring, like how many more people can afford to get into that market, develop the hardware, and then develop the open source software, maybe to make a competitor that's more open, that we might be able to have a bit more say over how things work or what happens. But I will give this other example, which I think is really interesting. And that is video cameras for homes are kind of fascinating. So we have a perimeter system. It's made by Swan. They have a ridiculously poorly designed set of usability around their software. But we don't have to run anything through a Swan company that's outside of our house, right? So we're privacy advocates, as Doc mentioned, customer commons and all of the things that I focus on in my tech work is very much privacy oriented. So the way that we set up the Swan system is we have the cameras outside. We don't have any cameras inside. We have a hard drive that is on a battery system that will run it for like a month, and also the internet, which is fiber. And so therefore, if somebody cut the power or started clipping, wires, thinking that they were going to shut this down, they would have a hard time because they'd have to break into the house to do it. But they could do that, and they could run off with the hard drive or the power boxes or the internet. But the video is copied to an encrypted, secure thing in the cloud that we control, and we don't share it with anybody. And we don't even really look at it because we don't really care until there's an incident, We have had instances where the Mountain View police have come by and realized we had a really good camera and we're a block away from a bank and there was a bank robbery and the bank robber drove down our street. And then they say, can we have that footage because it's part of our investigation? And they can see the person and the license plate and the whole thing. So, you know, we don't mind sharing that at all, but we don't want the police to have everything all the time and be able to do a giant dragnet. So there's like a privacy consideration. And then there's the functionality of it. You know, like, how do you set this up? It is not easy. And to think of these things, nobody's creating a system like what we made. We had to string it together and kind of hack it into place to do, you know, meet the physical need of, you know, having cameras that would go around the building and, you know, take care of security issues, and then have a copy here that we can look at, and then also have an encrypted copy in the cloud in case we lose what's here for one reason or another. And, you know, the Swan makes a really good camera. Their software is terrible, but there is a company, which I'm blanking on the name, but Doc knows him. He's from Jerry's group. We met him Sanford through Jerry's
Dickert.
Thing.
And Sanford Dickert.
Dickert. So Sanford has been working with a couple of kind of startup incubators to incubate a company that is actually doing great work creating software that can be swapped in for what many of the other camera manufacturers provide. But Swan won't use them. They're the only company, at least I believe, until the last time I asked them was really, you know, a few months ago. Swan still won't do it because they're the leader in the marketplace. So what I'm trying to describe is, you know, there's what we wanted to do. There's what the market wants to do, which is just provide people with security cameras, right? And there's a whole bunch of manufacturers. So in other words, more breadth and depth than what is in the doorbell business for Ring and Nest. But, you know, how do you set it up? It's complicated for homeowners and people who are renters and things. And then you have this issue of, you know, here's somebody who's come along and who's making software that's better than what all the camera makers have, but the lead seller of home video systems won't use it. And they have a really terrible UI. It's really hard to deal with it. And so what do I do? Because I'm not a coder and I'm not as technical as Ed is. Ed is the guy who goes in there, my partner, and he goes in and figures it out and, you know, gets the video out for the police if they come by or whatever, you know, for a couple of times.
Well, like you said, there's a trade-off there, right? I mean, you know, he has to, like, I was just going to bring up the fact that there are open source projects that people can use to, you know, at least on the back end, you know, to monitor some of this stuff and interact with it. OpenHAB is one. We did a show, I just looked it up, it's Floss Weekly 312 back in 2014. We've been doing the show a long time. But Floss Weekly 312, we talked about OpenHAB, which was pretty early on the scene. And then lately, Home Assistant has come out, and that one's a little bit more user-friendly, but you still have to, even setting up a Raspberry Pi and running it on the Raspberry Pi, as easy as that sounds to some of us, that's not going to be easy for the average homeowner. So, you know, it really is kind of a trade-off back and forth versus, you know, making it easy for people, but then also, like you say, the privacy concerns, you know, because I don't want, that's why I set up my own light switches with my own relays, even though I can get them from China. And I do get them from China. I just reprogram them. I don't know how their software sets up and what information they're sending back to their servers. So I'm like, we're just going to overwrite that software. I'm going to put my own software on it. Right. Not that I'm a privacy wonk, but I think everybody needs to be a little concerned about it. So yeah, it's a little bit of a catch 22 there in terms of, you know, knowing if you have the right technical resources yourself to go do this, or you go hire someone to set it up, or you just rely on whatever Google or whatever vendor it is providing the functionality in your house.